Diolch yn fawr iawn am y croeso. I can assure you that none of the fees that you have paid will be going directly to the pocket of politicians. There's no increase in fees, hopefully, this year. But I know Mark spoke last night in the dinner, and I'm aware of the fact that I think this is the first time I've actually addressed this event. Mae'n bleser felly i mi no, gyda chi heddi yn Confederation Gwasanaeth Iechyd, yn y cynhadledd mlynyddol yma yng Nghaerdydd. Ac wrth i ni dynnu at ddiwedd y tymor cynulliad yma, fel prif weinidog, hoffwn ddathlu gwaith rhyfeddol y Gwasanaeth Iechyd Gwladol yng Nghymru dros cyfnod y 5 mlynedd diwetha. Ac wrth gwrs i ddiolch i chi am bopeth chi wedi wneud, ac i ystyried ar y heriau sydd o'n blaenet. Great pleasure to be with you all at the NHS Confederation Conference here in Cardiff today. And as we draw to the end of this five-year Assembly term, as First Minister, I want to celebrate the astonishing work of the National Health Service in Wales over that period, and to thank you for everything that you have done. And also, of course, to reflect on the challenges that lie ahead. Now, there are few people or organisations that properly deserve the description of national treasure. There are even fewer politicians, certainly ones that are alive, who deserve that title. But the NHS in Wales, for me, is squarely in that small group. It's the one label for the NHS which David Cameron and I might agree on. To appropriate a phrase of its funder, this is my truth. There's not a single person among Wales' 3 million people who has not been touched by the NHS in some way. Some of you will know that my wife Lisa received treatment for leukemia some 20 years ago. The treatment she needed and the bone marrow transplant that she had was provided for free. It saved her life. Treatment, of course, under an insurance-based health system would be costing vast amounts of money, particularly for those who need, of course, treatment if they are in a position where they've relapsed. And so we know that the health service is there to care for people no matter what their underlying state of health is and no matter how many times they need that treatment for a particular condition. And the knowledge that the NHS will be there for free when we need it most is a fundamental building block to our way of life here in Wales. There are few countries in the world where this is true. We should never take it for granted. We've all experienced the care provided day and night by a system that doesn't sleep, and so many of us have, of course, to be grateful for the world-class treatment that's on offer by professionals who go beyond the call of duty because they care. And caring is at the heart of what you do every day, that priceless commodity that transforms lives, both those receiving it and, I hope, rewarding those who provide it. So on behalf of the Welsh Government, thank you for everything you've achieved together for Wales. But because the NHS has been around for as long as many of us can remember, it's easy to take what it delivers for granted. For a population of 3 million people, we have around 19 million contacts with primary care and our GPs. There are 4 million outpatient attendances. 1 million people attend A&E. We have 750,000 admissions, over 400,000 of which are emergency admissions. We have 700,000 optician visits. We issue 78 million prescriptions. Now, statistics tell you a lot, but they convey the sheer, awesome scale of what the NHS does. Now, incidentally, I've noted the English Department of Health's sudden apparent obsession with a seven-day NHS. As everyone in the room knows, the NHS is and has always been exactly that. It's not exactly news, Mr. Hunt. But what really moves me are the individual stories. The individual lives improved, transformed, yeah, saved by the service. And these happen right across the NHS every hour of every day. But let's focus today on one hospital in Wales, Morriston in Swansea, a hospital that I have a particular interest in. It's where I was born. It's a hospital that gave my mother tremendous care. I was a difficult birth, as I was reminded annually on my birthday. My mother, bless her, was alive. But certainly, a high forceps delivery that was carried out in the 60s, and certainly it's the case that the hospital that saved both my life and my mother's life at that time, many years ago. But back to modern-day Morriston. Just in the last few days, We've heard the story of seven-month-old Ruby Davis, who has literally found her feet again after 3 months in plaster. She was born with hip dysplasia, which could have left her with a lifetime of hip pain and a limp. The conventional treatment wasn't effective, but consultant orthopaedic surgeon Neil Price from Morriston Hospital carried out a procedure called a closed reduction. Ruby was in plaster from her chest to her knees for 3 months. Now it's been removed. And because it was caught early enough and through that consultant's skill, she should now have a completely normal life. Now Ruby's family can't praise the team enough, saying that they've gone above and beyond the call of duty to make sure she's getting the best care, both now and as she grows up. I don't know whether there's lightning or not, but I actually not be struck by lightning any point in time. I noticed when I came in, actually, that the same sound occurred. It was like a drum roll when I came in. There we are. Hopefully it won't happen again. Above and beyond the call of duty. How often do we hear that phrase used to describe our NHS staff? Also at Morriston, Stephen Power, who suffered terrible facial injuries following a motorcycle crash, became one of the first trauma patients in the world to have 3D printing used at every stage of his facial reconstruction surgery. His surgeon, Adrian Sugar, says the results are in a different league from anything they've done before, and Mr. Power has called the results life-changing. His operation was featured at an exhibition at the Science Museum in London. So, world-class treatment changing lives. And of course, we shouldn't forget the research going on right across the country every day within the NHS, which has the potential to transform even more lives in the future. In the same hospital that Ruby and Stephen were treated, a groundbreaking group of researchers at Morriston's amazing specialist burns unit are working with engineers and scientists to develop 3D printed tissue made from human cells for the first time. And they hope that in a few years' time, patients who've lost all or part of their ear or nose through trauma or cancer could have reconstruction using new tissue, which is grown, of course, from their own cells. And real-life surgical trials could start in as little as 3 or 4 years' time. Now, this is science fiction stuff, which, thanks to the NHS, is becoming science fact. Now, I focused on Swansea, but I could just as well have talked about the superb cardiac surgery team in Cardiff, really one of the best across the UK. Stroke services in the north of Wales are now being held up as a beacon for others to follow, thanks to minimising the time taken to assess and treat. Howell Bar Health Board has won a national award for helping to improve the health and quality of life of people living with type 2 diabetes. So for many reasons, I think the NHS in Wales deserves its privileged place in our national life. But of course, being placed on a pedestal comes at a price, and that price is unrelenting public scrutiny. Now, let me be clear, the NHS in Wales, like any highly complex system anywhere in the world, is not perfect. And with a budget of £7 billion a year, it's wholly appropriate that it should be under the spotlight. As a government, we've intervened several times over the past 5 years to put right things we've seen are going wrong. It hasn't been easy, it hasn't been done lightly, but for me, it was necessary, and it's delivered results. But ask those people who know best, the patients, what they think, and we get a clear answer. More than 9 out of 10 patients rate the care they've received as good or excellent. And in the world of customer satisfaction, that's a decent return by any standards. And surely it's the best antidote, if I might use a medical phrase, to those who would systematically run the service down for their own ends. A crisis is an easy headline to write about a system. But when people face a crisis of their own, as the statistics show, the system's there for them. But we can't be complacent. We want that figure to be 10 out of 10. And that is the even steeper challenge we must all set ourselves in the future. But as First Minister, when I reflect on the last 5 years and the severe constraints we faced in public spending, I look at the investment that we've put in to our NHS and to social care, and I know that we did the right thing. Now, since I'm frequently faced with comparisons with England across the Assembly Chamber, I make no apology for putting them on the record here today. At the end of this Assembly, spending per head on health in Wales remains higher than England. Spending on health and social care combined is considerably higher, meaning fewer people are left languishing in hospital when their recovery could be so much quicker elsewhere. Pounds and pence are important, not just to the NHS finance directors here today, but there's another, arguably even sharper dividing line that's opened up between us here in Wales and across the border in England. Our philosophy for the NHS is fundamentally this. It's paid for from the public purse to deliver the public good. It's accountable to ministers, and citizens know where they stand. For all of the myriad of complex and technologically advanced treatments it now offers, its basic structure is relatively simple and easy to understand. In England, ministers have embarked on a reform so dizzying in its complexity, so baffling in its structure, and so opaque in terms of its accountability, that patients there could be forgiven for wondering who, if anyone, is actually in charge. I won't attempt to explain any further, I'll only say this. On this dividing line, and I expect the vast majority of people in this room share this view, we are very happy to be on the side of simplicity, delivery, and of course the strong philosophy that this is a public good paid for from the public purse. Now let me be very clear, wholesale national top-down reorganisation is not on the agenda. The NHS has better things to do than conjure with elected health commissioners, deconstruct primary care, or create a vast new health quango that would be bigger than the government itself. You need to be allowed to get on with a job, not worry about political projects. Now, as many of you know, the OECD have recently been carrying out a four-country comparison of health services in the UK. Their report is due to be published soon, so we'll have to wait to see what it says. But during the OECD's research visit to Wales last year, we were able to emphasise to them, time after time, the commitment to quality which runs right through the NHS here. It's embedded in everything that you do. It's an essential building block of what a world-class health service is, delivering cutting-edge treatment for all. We saw similar conclusions in the last Four Nation Health Study, and I very much expect that will be once again reflected and recognised in the final OECD report. The message can then go out nationally and internationally that the quality of treatment that we offer is the equal of anyone, anywhere. That includes our neighbours across Offa's Tyne. In some ways, the changes to the health service in England have actually been useful to us here in Wales. Why do I say that? Well, they've served to illustrate the more consensual partnership approach that we've taken here. What better illustration of that is there, that images of junior doctors in open revolt in England standing outside their hospitals with placards rather than inside treating patients. In Wales, junior doctors stay on the wards. Why? Because we respect their profession enough to say that we won't unilaterally impose new contracts. We're not interested in macho confrontation for the simple reason that the patient, and that's what this is all, it's all about, doesn't benefit. As a government, we've had some ups and downs with the British Medical Association over the past 5 years. It would be strange if we hadn't, given the financial pressures we faced. But I'd like to quote the BMA Wales Chair today, Dr. Phil Banfield, who I see is sitting in front of me. So I hope that the quote is actually accurate. He said, I'm sure he can correct me afterwards, there is a commitment in the NHS in Wales that whatever the solution, it will come from collaboration, not confrontation. Just as we welcome the fact that Wales dares to tread a different policy path aimed at preserving Bevan's principles, we're encouraged by the Welsh Government's recognition that doctors have a key role in delivering this vision. Doctors are therefore respected partners. Hear, hear. And that goes for doctors, of course, for nurses, consultants, support staff, managers, all those who have to run the health service, and everyone else who works hard to make the system what it is today. Because if our approach shows one thing, it's that the false and dangerous dichotomy of being either on the side of the patient or on the side of the NHS has to be avoided at all costs. As the bitter dispute in England shows little sign of being resolved, I'm confident that the Welsh spirit of collaboration, based on Bevan's principles, is the best and most effective way of avoiding this damaging path now and in the future. As another tangible illustration of this approach, we, together with the BMA, unions and the NHS as a whole, are working on a set of common values that link all of this together. They'll be launched shortly. And they'll seek to lay out those things which bring us together, which inspire us, and which set the direction of the NHS for the future. So, what is the future? Well, the next 5 years will be make or break for the Welsh NHS. We need to prove to the Welsh public that the model that we have of healthcare is the right one. We have to do more to put the patient voice at the heart of the NHS. We'll go further to integrate care between NHS and social care without wholesale top-down reorganisation. We'll deliver more care closer to home, improving the way health and care is delivered. We'll continue to rise to the budgetary challenges with more money than ever before for our NHS and social care, despite the cuts from Westminster. There'll be a renewed focus on tackling the most stubborn of waiting times, and there will be no compromise on quality. Our NHS will continue to improve results for the public. On the 1st of April, the Wellbeing of Future Generations Act, one of the landmark laws passed during this Assembly, comes into force. Uniquely, it places legal duties on 44 public sector organisations, including the Welsh Government and the bodies which make up the NHS in Wales, to work together to pursue 7 long-term national goals. Among them is a healthier Wales. And here's one of the really significant areas where all of us, from individuals through to health boards, to local authorities and government, have to focus our efforts in order to pursue that shared national goal. It's so simple, I suppose, that it barely needs restating, but so fundamental to our future as a nation and to the National Health Service that it can't be said often enough. Over recent years, we've seen demand on and expectations around NHS services increase dramatically. Investment's risen, that's true, but the service too has risen to the challenge. Freed from the distraction of wholesale structural reorganisation and upheaval, you've rolled up your sleeves and you've got on with the job. But you will all know that the projections that we have make tough reading. The demography of those needing care will continue to widen, and the growing issues of childhood obesity and diabetes will place an ever greater strain on services. I had a discussion with somebody the other day who was making the point to me that it's a marvellous thing to see that statistics with regard to heart disease are improving, strokes improving as people take more responsibility for their lives and they're doing more exercise when they're younger. But the same person also made the point to me that means you're going to have more hip and knee replacements in years to come. We can't actually legislate for the frailties of the human body, but much better, of course, to have somebody who needs a joint replacement than somebody who has a serious stroke and, of course, needs care for the rest of their lives. The way that budgets are calculated have changed, of course, over time. But in 1999, health spending represented 39% of the Welsh block grant. This year, the equivalent figure will be 48% of our budget. Now, I make no apology for making the NHS a priority, and the people of Wales will rest assured that we will continue to do so. You hear some insist that we spend still more on the NHS while also increasing spending everywhere else. It's impossible, given the cuts to our budget. And anyone who tries to persuade the people of Wales that it's possible to increase spending in every area of government is taking the Welsh public for fools. For the NHS, though, we know it's about making every pound count, being ruthless in the pursuit of inefficiency and waste, and planning effectively to deliver more within the budgets available. It's about continuing to embrace Health Minister Mark Drakeford's prudent healthcare agenda, which he's pioneered, in fairness, and driven forward with enormous energy, and which I know has been welcomed right across the service in Wales and further afield. It's about working ever more closely with the social care sector, integrating when it makes sense, providing an intelligently planned pathway for each individual according to their needs, and removing the stubborn blockages in a system caused by one service not talking properly to another. Our record on delayed transfers of care is substantially better than England because we've chosen not to slash social care budgets. And we won't seek to offload future costs onto councils and council taxpayers, as the Chancellor is doing there. But there's more that needs to be done. And there's more that will be done. Not least thanks to the Social Services and Wellbeing Act. This sets out an expectation about integration, that this should help to deliver a health and social care system that helps staff to work together. It's when I step on that, you can see that, the noise happens, I'll move away from it. A health and social care system that helps staff to work across disciplines together with and for the patients. We have the Intermediate Care Fund that's provided a blueprint for what properly integrated services should look like, with a series of projects which save money, but of course deliver better care in the process. And those at the front line know what the issues are. We need to listen more to them and move rapidly to replicate the success stories that we do see right around Wales. So there is a responsibility on public services across the board to increase the pace of change for the better and collaboration. There's a duty on all of us to take greater responsibility for our own health and the decisions which we make that affect our own lives. But despite the challenges facing it, the NHS in Wales is a robust and resilient organisation. Over the past 5 years, it's been tested by austerity, but it's prevailed. And the number of those who are out there living in Wales with cause to be grateful for its care and treatment has continued to grow. Over the last 5 years, we've shown our commitment to the NHS and remain committed to the simple idea that it will always be there for each of Wales's 3 million people when they need it most. A good health service cannot be delivered by one individual or group of people alone. It cannot be delivered solely by government alone. It needs the support and expertise of so many in this room and beyond who work in our health service, who deliver the care that people need and deserve. A system that has stood the test of time since the late 1940s, and a system that continues to deliver for the people of Wales now. And that's down to you. So thank you for your amazing work. Thank you for listening, and do enjoy the rest of the day.